Good morning. Welcome to St. John United Church of Christ, Manchester. Thank you for tuning in to worship this morning. And I want to begin with some wonderful news, and that is this past week, Tracy Harris started as our designated pastor here at St. John, and she is with us in worship this morning.
Good morning. Glad to see everybody. Sort of.
We have a little information in the e-blast for you that you can read about Tracy, and our next newsletter, The Friendly Call, will have a picture and a bio of Tracy as well. Throughout the next couple of months, we will try to find ways for all of you to get to meet and to connect with Tracy as she begins her ministry with us. But it's truly a joy to have her on staff and look forward to the work ahead with one another. Some other announcements. One is that we still have a little time left here in the month of August. The outreach is doing meal makers. If you've got a chance, please get some hamburger helper, mac and cheese, or other items and drop them off here at the church. We have the large black bin by the back door where you can just put your things in there, and the outreach team will make sure that they get over to Circle of Concern. Hopefully you will have seen in the announcements that we are overjoyed by the arrival of Sarah Rieger and Joaquin Buckley's son, Isaiah Michael, who was born last Sunday. Congratulations to the entire Rieger family at this time. Isaiah Michael was 8 pounds, 1 ounce, and was 21 and a half inches long. This is fantastic news. Mom and baby are doing well, so we just rejoice with all of them at this time. And on a sad note, we did receive word this past week about the death of Robert Meyer back in July. And we also learned that his wife, Judy, has moved to Ohio now to be near her son. So we express our condolences to the entire family at this time. And we also express our sympathies on the loss of Joy Mesley. Many of you will remember Ken and Joy Mesley in this congregation. So we certainly keep the Mesleys in our prayers as they mourn the loss of a matriarch. At this point, there are no arrangements made for either one of them, but we certainly wanted to communicate with all of you. That's all the announcements that I have. At this time, I invite you, as we've been doing, to share the peace of Christ with one another by typing a comment to one another on Facebook, or saying God's peace to the family that is sitting with you and worshiping with you, or you know, however it is that you feel the peace of Christ at this time. So, peace of Christ to all of you this morning. Our opening hymn is Praise to the Lord the Almighty.
Thank you. gracious God, we believe that you care for humble people who seek to follow your way. You have protected your people when they were surrounded by trouble. You have provided an escape in the midst of cruelty. Your love never fails. Work within and among us to renew our minds and hearts. Build your community into the health you intend for all your children. You are our help and our hope. In Christ we pray. Amen.
We come now to a time with our children. And I found a few things down in one of our classrooms because I don't have any of these items at my house anymore. But I found with me some things that are used for babies. So for instance, I've got a diaper here that can be put on a baby so that, you know, they stay dry and so that they are comforted. I've also got with me here a baby blanket, and this is what keeps a baby warm. I've also got this toy here that can be used to kind of keep a baby, I think, entertained and occupied. Although I can't figure out, oh, there's the last one. And there are certainly many other things, like a baby bottle so that a child is fed. You can also have a pumpkin seat to make sure that they're safe in the car. These are all things that we use to take care of babies. The reason I share this is because this morning, Pastor Tracy is going to be reading a story about another baby. And this baby grew up kind of and was born during a time that was a little dangerous. But the mother put the baby in a basket to make sure that it kept warm and that it was comfortable. And then the mother, she pushed that basket down a river so that the baby would be safe. And there are many other women who took care of this baby to ensure that he would grow up and that he would have a chance to live and to be able to serve God and do all of the great things that he was intended to do. And that little baby was Moses. And so we need to give thanks that all of those women were very creative and thought of ways to make sure that Moses had a chance to grow up, because he became one of God's great leaders of the faith. I hope that you will listen to the story and that you will think about not only how it is that Moses was cared for, but how it is that we care for children and babies and what we can do to ensure their safety and their well-being in this time and place. So let us pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for the many stories about little ones in the Bible, for how it is that you look out over all your children and you care for us in amazing ways. May this help us and strengthen us as we go about serving you and serving our little ones. This we ask in your precious name. Amen.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. whether they are spoken or unspoken. And this morning, I hope you will join me with your prayers as we pray for the needs of our friends and neighbors. Send the attitude of prayer. Siblings in Christ, God invites us to hold the needs of our sisters and brothers as dear as our own. Loving our neighbors and ourselves, we offer our thanksgiving and our petitions on behalf of the church and the world. In the world, we pray for the wildfires in California. May there be refreshing rains to suppress them. Pray for hurricanes that may be forming. We also ask that you comfort those who are mourning. You know those who have lost loved ones recently, and we ask that you comfort them with your palms around and hold them in your strong hands. We also ask, Lord, that you bless those who may be ill, suffering from COVID or any other chronic illnesses. We ask that you pray that you be with those who have cancer and other illnesses that require your strength daily. Walk through any illness with us. We ask that we feel your love surround us, but we also celebrate things that are joyful, birth of babies, birthdays, anniversaries, and recoveries from illnesses. Open our hearts in compassion and receive these petitions on behalf of the needs of your people, the church and the world to whom you sent Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Oh, Thanks be to God.
That was a mouthful. We had to, kind of break Tracy in here with one of our lengthier scripture passages for this morning. Let us join together in prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of each of our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. As you noticed, I was gone from worship last Sunday. A special thanks to Tim and Grace and Mike for leading worship last week. I was moving my oldest daughter, Sarah, down to Alabama, where she got a new job. This weekend it was moving Samuel back to school, and next weekend I will be taking Grace back to college. With Sarah this time, it was a little different than moving her into a dorm room. The apartment was not furnished. There was no bed, no desk, no couch, or anything else. It was empty. Thus, we had to load up all of her furniture onto a U-Haul truck. This wasn't an easy task. The furniture was heavy and awkward. Samuel helped me load the truck at home. The plan all along was for me to go by myself. Laura was quite nervous and kept saying, "But how are you going to move the stuff in by yourself?" Since Sarah's livelihood is her back and feet, she's in no position to help carry anything. As I got behind the wheel of this truck, I thought, driving is simple, but how am I going to get this stuff off the truck? There was no ramp on the back, and the edge of the truck was high off the ground. I can't even begin to count how many times we all commented, "But how is this going to work?" That's what I want to focus on this morning. The buts in our story and the buts in our lives. The Exodus passage today has many of them. For instance, Egypt set taskmasters over the Israelites to oppress them with forced labor. But the more they were oppressed, the more they multiplied and spread, so that the Egyptians came to dread the Israelites. A few verses later, "When you act as midwives to the Hebrew women and see them on the birthstool, if it is a boy, kill him. But the midwives feared God. They did not do as the king of Egypt commanded them, but they let the boys live." Since that didn't work, Pharaoh demanded, "Every boy that is born to the Hebrews shall be thrown into the Nile, but you shall let every girl live." That's a lot of buts in this text. The author gave the word a break when he got to the second chapter. Still, what does it mean to have this short conjunction appear that many times in the story? The word "but" is used to introduce something that contrasts with what has already been said. How often have we been in a conversation with someone and they respond, "I really like your idea, but..." It's become an indication that someone disagrees with us. After a while, hearing too many buts causes us to roll our eyes in disgust. That's not what we wanted to hear. Everything was going fine until someone said, but. This is viewed nowadays as a negative response in our culture. Maybe you make a project proposal in the office. Management says that the concept is good, but now is not the right time. Perhaps you go get tests taken at the hospital and the results come back negative, but the doctor tells you they found something else. Or your daughter says she's coming into town for a visit with the grandchildren. Oh yes, but she has some news. She and her husband are getting divorced. A church member is excited to serve on a committee in the congregation. That doesn't happen. That's a bad example. A member of the church says that they're excited to serve on a committee, but then they are transferred to Colorado for a new job and they can't serve. The buts that arise tend to be seen as a nuisance, a bother, a terrible thing. Is there another way? Is there a divine way that we might interpret the buts in the Moses story and our story? When we close the book of Genesis, the descendants of Jacob are comfortably rooted as an established people in the land of Egypt. Jacob's son Joseph is a local hero, having navigated the nation through a dreadful period of famine. Even though people mourn the death of Joseph, the Egyptians and Israelites are living peacefully in the land together. But turn the page, and the story is suddenly different. We open the book of Exodus, and in almost no time we see that the Israelites' circumstances have changed dramatically. The Bible informs us that a new king arose over Egypt who did not know Joseph. Joseph was gone. The Pharaoh who knew Joseph's significance was gone. Time marches on. We know how that goes in life. After a certain period, we completely forget the importance of a person or an event. Just look at sports teams, politicians, or friends. How quickly things can change on a dime. The same can be said of Egypt. A new pharaoh takes office, and those descendants of Joseph are getting to be too numerous and powerful within the land. Pharaoh decides to destroy the Hebrew people in order to maintain his control. But the more Pharaoh oppressed the Israelites, the more they multiplied. But the more he tried to kill the baby boys, the more the midwives resisted. This story from Exodus challenges us today. The passage is full of conflict, violence, and fear, which we would rather avoid, especially now. It's talking about killing babies. We don't want to discuss this kind of news because, one, we have come to romanticize the Bible as this wonderful book of pleasantries, and two, people get enough of that awful news from the media. So the church becomes a place to escape from the world. But that's not how God works. I consider this in the context of 2020. People are tired of hearing about the coronavirus and the ways this has upended our lives. Folks want to gather for parties again and resume normal life. But the virus must still be mitigated. Others are exhausted by the protests and unrest across our country. Some just want to move on because we've made enough progress already in our nation. But race relations still need to be addressed. We all wish the political ads and the divisive rhetoric would cease in the United States. But there are still 72 days until the election. And let's face it, this won't end after November 3rd. What's happening in your personal life that you would like to avoid or escape, but the issue doesn't go away? The Christian faith is no miracle cure for the but that is revealed. Instead, our faith raises to consciousness this contrast that already exists. We view buts as an annoying conflict. However, God looks at them as an opportunity to explore and embrace a new way of being. By the end of this story, we learn the name of this little baby, Moses. In Hebrew, the meaning of Moses' name is to draw out or to deliver. After everything that has occurred, the Lord delivers this baby boy who goes on to lead God's people. We never would have thought that at the beginning with the oppression and murder. But the Lord wasn't through. God delivers Moses, and God delivers the people of Israel. The conjunctions, the conflicts, the frustrations, the buts in our lives is the very place where the Lord is present and delivers us for doing great things. Some people might say, yeah, but my situation hasn't turned around, or things aren't getting better. My response is, but God isn't finished yet. There will be more buts to our story. There will be more moments where God delivers us for doing the work of Christ Jesus. How many times did we read that in today's passage? It wasn't one and done in Exodus. The Lord was constantly having to work anew in bringing about the hoped for outcome. The message in this text is one in which the power of God is constantly living and moving in our midst. It may not appear that way at times, but there is that moment when the living Spirit of God enters our lives to deliver us and to encourage us for a brighter tomorrow. Isn't that the good news of the gospel? Read all four Easter stories in Scripture, and you will find that they all have one word in common. After the Sabbath, as the first day of the week was dawning, the women went to the tomb where he lay. For fear of him, the guards shook and became like dead men. What do you think the next word is? But. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid. I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has been raised." In all the resurrection appearances, there is a but. For God delivers Jesus, and God delivers all of us through life and death to new life once again. I know you're sitting on the edge of your chair with coffee in hand. So, what happened in Alabama? How did the story end? Did John and Susie get together? Anyhow, I'm not gonna lie, it was tricky. The entire drive down, I processed how I would get stuff off the truck and moved into Sarah's apartment. When we arrived, one by one, I unloaded each piece of furniture. Her mattresses, her dresser, her awkward desk with the heavy hutch, her couch, her chair, and all the other boxes and bins. I managed to do it all by myself. Maybe that's a bit braggadocious, but I was pleasantly surprised with what God could draw out of me, and I was relieved that God delivered me and Sarah in that moment. You want to put up the picture, Grace? Grace has put up a picture. I took a selfie when I was done and sent it to our family group text. Look at the caption. I didn't realize it at the time when I sent it, but what does the top of that caption say? Don't doubt, but believe. The words of our Savior. We tend to see the buts as irritating interruptions in our pursuit of happiness. But God views these instances as a holy occasion to help us and to change us for a greater purpose in the world. Allow me to leave you with one message this morning, and that is, resist the temptation to interpret buts as a negative thing to avoid. Rather, as challenging as it may be, explore and embrace the buts in your life as a divine moment for the Lord to transform and strengthen you for a blessed future in Christ. The story of Moses and the Hebrew people took a bizarre but surprising turn for the good. So did the life of Jesus Christ. That's what God is aiming to do through each of us. May we recognize the but as a chance in which God draws out our faith and delivers us for new life. Praise the Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
as I mentioned in my sermon, next weekend I take Grace back to school. She has been with us for 5 months now, and it was back in March when I picked her up in the car and brought her home, and I said that we had to cancel worship, and she commented to me, "Well, we can just do it on Facebook." And I looked at her like, "We can?" And she says, "Oh yeah, sure." And she says, "I've done this a lot." She says, "I know how to do it." And so that's kind of how we worked with Tim and with Stephen to get this going. And she has been here each Sunday working behind the scenes, doing the cameras to make sure that the productions have gone well. And we can't thank you enough for doing that. And this summer she took on the role of entering all of the frames and uploading to the YouTube channel and has been making things run smoothly. And so we are going to miss you, Grace, but you need to go back to school and finish your senior year and hope that you will continue to get on and watch our broadcasts, and hopefully, yes, we will kind of pick up where you left off and do well. But it's hard to believe that she's been doing this for 5 months with us, and so we truly appreciate it, sweetheart.
As my dad was saying, on March 16th, he picked me up from school and we drove home. And while driving home, I asked him how church would run if we were practicing social distancing. He said church was canceled until we could figure something else out. And I started to think about what could be done. And I brought up doing a live stream service. My dad asked if we could really do that. And I told him we could stream on Facebook, and all he would need to do is have his usual Sunday materials ready, and all we needed was a phone. That week, I was made an administrator on the church Facebook. We began the journey of worshiping online. With help from Tim, we developed our church service to be what it is today. I learned how to create Switcher Studio slides to switch screens and how to upload worship services to YouTube. Every Sunday is new and exciting as I set up the cameras, give Tim the thumbs up, occasionally ring the bell, handling all the kinks as we sometimes lose signal, reading through all of the comments at the end, giving wild hand motions to back away from the camera and move out of the way so that you're not in the screen before the service. Sometimes I run around with the camera to get cool perspectives and angles. Most of all, though, I have loved connecting with the congregation I have grown up with. Each and every one of you is a part of this St. John family. I can't count how many times I have told my dad, "We serve an amazing congregation." I appreciate your patience, encouragement, grace, suggestions, love, and faithfulness despite unfathomable circumstances. During one service early on in these last 6 months, my dad preached on loss, and I played Rise Up by Andre Day over the loudspeaker system. I cried looking around the empty sanctuary, realizing this was our life now, and thinking, I can't do this indefinitely. But you have shown me the love of Christ each Sunday, and that support keeps me going when I'm tired, frustrated, worried, or when the YouTube upload is just taking too long after worship. This will be my last Sunday in person, and it has been my pleasure being your production manager the last 5 months. I will probably find a way to pop into a service at some point. After all, it is online and the internet is everywhere. But for now, I love you all. Thank you for sharing the unceasing love of Christ with me and one another. You are precious in God's eyes. You are God's wonder and delight. Carry God's love gently and firmly to all you meet. May God walk close beside you so you may scatter seeds of love, sing songs of joy, shape communities of peace, and build bridges of hope. Amen.